Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP ENCOR, Enterprise Core exam. In this lab, we will review some of the CEF concepts we looked at in the previous video, as well as a couple new ones. The network for this lab is fairly simple. We have four subnets, 192.168.12.0/24 between R1 and R2, .13.0 between R1 and R3, .24.0 between R2 and R4, and .34.0 between R3 and R4. But the actual topology isn't that important. For this lab, I just placed a few routers and configured routing protocols to populate R1's routing table with some routes. In this lab, we'll be examining the different tables used by CEF on R1. Now let's get right into the lab instructions. Step 1 says, in the list of processes running on R1 CPU, identify the process responsible for process switching packets. Do you remember the name of that process? It's IP input. Let's go on R1 to look for it. Enable. The command to view the processes running on the CPU is show processes CPU. However, there will be nearly 400 processes, so instead of scrolling through all of the output, I'll stop it, and let's try again and filter the output. Use the pipe, and then I for include, and I'll type IP input, all lowercase. Nothing. That's because when filtering command output, it is case sensitive, so let me type it properly. Uppercase IP, and then input with an uppercase I. And now we can see it, IP input. This is the process on the CPU that will handle packets that CEF can't. Okay, let's return to the lab notes for step 2 and step 3. Step 2 says to examine the rib of R1, and also step 3 says to examine the fib and compare it to the rib. It asks, what entries are present in the fib but not the rib? So let's return to R1 and view the rib. The rib, routing information base, is just another name for the routing table, so I'll view it with show IP route. Okay, so R1 is running EIGRP, as indicated by the D for these routes, and OSPF, as indicated by the O. It also has a couple static routes configured, both to 8.8.4.4, so R1 will load balance over the two routes. And of course there are its connected and local routes. When doing process switching of packets, R1 will look up routes in this table and choose the most specific matching route. For example, show IP route 192.168.24.4. So when R1 has to forward a packet to 192.168.24.4, it will select this route to 24.0/24. So let's compare the rib to the fib, the table that CEF uses. Show IP CEF. Okay, the first thing I notice is that the fib table has more entries than the rib. And another thing I'd like to point out is how simple the information is. Prefix, next hop, interface. Just the information R1 needs to properly forward the packets. It doesn't include information like the routing protocol, administrative distance, or metric. Remember, AD and metric are used to select which routes are inserted into the routing table. But once routes are in the routing table, that information is no longer relevant for selecting which route to use to forward a packet. So that information is not in the fib. Just like I did with the routing table, I can use show IP CEF 192.168.24.4, and it will show me the fib entry that would be selected to forward a packet to this destination. I can also use show IP CEF detail, and this will display more detailed information about each route. There are lots of other options for the show IP CEF command, such as show IP CEF, followed by an interface name such as G00. Displays the entries attached to that interface, or using it as a next hop. Okay, now step 3 asked what routes are present in the fib, but not the rib. So once again, I'll just do show IP CEF. I pointed most of these out in the lecture video. For example, there are drop entries for reserved ranges like 0.0.0.0/8, 127.0.0.0/8, 224.0.0.0/4, which is class D, and 240.0.0.0/4, which is class E. If the router receives packets destined for addresses in these ranges, they will be dropped, unless the packets are matched by a more specific route. Another interesting thing is that there are entries for R1's layer 2 adjacencies, such as 192.168.12.2/32, which is the IP address of R2's G00 interface, and 192.168.13.3/32, which is the IP address of R3's G00 interface. There are also entries in the FIB for broadcast addresses and such, which aren't present in the routing table. Okay, there's a lot more we could explore about the show IPCEF command and its options, but let's return to the lab notes for step 4 and step 5. Step 4 says to examine the ARP table of R1, and step 5 says to examine the adjacency table and compare it to the ARP table. And there is a question: is neighbor resolution optimized? What effect does this have on CEF? This is something I didn't mention in the lecture video. If you did the lab yourself, hopefully you were able to find the answer for it on Google. It's probably not something you'll be asked about on the ENCOR exam, but there's no harm in digging a little deeper than required. So let's return to R1 and check the ARP table. The command is show ARP. Okay, there are 4 entries. 2 of them are R1's own addresses, and the others are R1's layer 2 adjacencies, R2G00 and R3G00. Now let's compare that to what's in R1's adjacency table used for CEF. Show adjacency. Okay, as I pointed out in the lecture video, this command doesn't really display much. One thing to note is that in the adjacency table, R1's own IP addresses aren't included, only those of its adjacencies. Okay, let's try show adjacency detail for more info. Okay, I'd say the major difference between the information here and the ARP table is that the adjacency table includes these pre-built Ethernet headers to encapsulate packets. For example, to send packets to nexttop 192.168.12.2, R1 should add this Ethernet header. The first 12 hex characters are the destination MAC, R2G00, and the next 12 after are the source MAC, R1G00. And then 0800 is the ether type for IPv4. Okay, now step 5 also asked about neighbor resolution optimization. To take a look at that, let's check the running config. Show run, and I'll use the pipe and do include CEF. Okay, only 2 commands are displayed, IPCEF and no IPv6 CEF. These commands are how you enable and disable CEF on the router, by the way. If you want to disable CEF for some reason, configure no IPCEF in global config mode. Anyway, this is not the output I wanted. That's because, by default, lots of default configurations are not displayed in the output of show running config. If you want to see every single command in the running config, including lots of default configurations and commands you've never heard of, use show running config all. And once again, I'll filter it with pipe include CEF. As you can see, compared to before, which only had 2 commands, there's a lot more output now. If you view the entire running config with show running config all, the config is extremely long, so I recommend filtering the output to find what you want. The command I want to show you is near the top, IPCEF optimize neighbor resolution. So the answer to question 5 is yes, neighbor resolution optimization is enabled. It's enabled by default on this IOSV router. So what does this feature do? It actually allows the router to handle ARP, neighbor resolution, within CEF. No need to send packets to the CPU. Okay, now let's return to the lab notes for step 6. It says to configure R1's interfaces to perform CEF load balancing on a per packet basis. The default load balancing method is per destination. That means that packets from host A to host B will always take the same path. Packets from host C to host D will always take the same path, etc. You can change that to per packet, in which each packet is considered individually, and packets from the same source to the same destination might be sent along different paths. Note that if packets are sent along different paths, there is a chance that they can arrive out of order, so some traffic might be negatively affected by that. Generally, per destination is fine, and you won't change it. but if you want to change it, you can configure it at the interface level. Note that if you want to configure per packet load balancing, you have to configure it on all outgoing interfaces over which traffic is shared. So let's configure it on R1's G00 and G01, so traffic will be load shared on a per packet basis over those interfaces. From the CLI of R1, let me first show you one way to confirm the default setting of per destination. The command is show CEF interface G00. Note that it's show CEF, not show IP CEF. And here it says, per packet load balancing is disabled. So let's enable it on G00 and G01. Conf T, interface range G00 to 1. The command is IP load sharing per packet. Okay, that's it. End. And let's check. Show CEF interface G00. Okay, as you can see, per packet load sharing is enabled. Now let's return to the lab notes for the final step, step 7. It asks, what is the default CEF load balancing algorithm? What options are there? I think this is beyond the scope of ENCOR, but I'm including it for a couple reasons. First, as I said before, there's no harm in digging a little deeper. And second, you should practice your Google skills to find answers to questions like this. For example, with a Google search, you should be able to find something like this Cisco documentation on CEF load balancing. And if I click down here, it'll take me to a section on load balancing algorithms. But instead of reading this documentation, I'll return to the CLI of R1 and show you it here. First, let me clarify. These load balancing algorithms are separate from the per destination and per packet configurations. You can select both the algorithm used to make load balancing decisions, and also whether those decisions should be made per destination or per packet. They are two different things. So, to check R1's default load balancing algorithm, I'll use show run all again, and pipe include algorithm. Here is the default load balancing algorithm on this IOSV router and other modern Cisco devices. It's called universal, and these numbers are an ID which is fed into the algorithm to influence the load balancing decision. So that's the answer. The default is universal. Now, what other options are there? Let's check. Conf T. The command is IP CEF load sharing algorithm, and let's check the options. So in IOSV, aside from the default of universal, there are four others. Tunnel helps provide load balancing in environments with tunnels, where packets often use the same source and destination IP addresses, those of the tunnel endpoints. Original is not recommended by Cisco anymore, as it often didn't produce good load balancing results. You can read the documentation if you're curious about the reason for that. Include ports adds the layer 4 port to the load balancing decision, not just the IP addresses. And the DPI option can also be useful in tunnel environments, as it tells the router to look into the internal packet to make the load balancing decision, not just the outer tunnel headers. Okay, in this lab, we reviewed some of the CEF concepts covered in the lecture video, and also introduced a few new concepts I didn't mention before. Although the labs in this course will generally follow what we covered in the lecture videos, I will occasionally include some additional topics like I did in this one. Okay, that's all for this lab. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Velva Jacob, George Streeter, Funny Dart, Nasir Chowdhury, Devin Suku, Gustavo Biar, Gerard Baker, Marcel Lord, Pavel M., Mr. Erlison, Drugger Sernea, Zakib Shah, Mayor Salman, Mazen Anderson, Vitaus194, Gina Lindley, Nahemia, Justin Watke, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillaum, Gabriel Braga, Renan Marias, Hector Hernandez, Ali Polat, Mara Tuba, Roji Kuriakos, Arpad Konives, 5 Feet, Daniel Brown, Tricky Mickey 123456, Scott Thompson, Jose Alvarez, Kevin Hayes, Hussein Yavuz, Samuel Tavares, Mustafa Irsoy, Dear Diso, Nasser Zahar, Alexandru Badic, Brian Grant, Georgi Gemejev, Ahmed Ismail, Dibya Swain, Tan No, Arlen Plagaria, Adelson Pereira, Abdozizo, Farad69, and Lucien Stoichitoyu. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So, if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching.